What does each node in the distributed system know? Every node knows its own events, meaning what are the computational events that are happening in its own execution. It also knows about its communication events with the rest of the nodes in the distributed system. So for instance, if this process PI sends a message to process PJ, that's a send event. PI knows about that. And similarly, PJ, when it gets this event, it's a receive event, it knows about that. So these are the only two kinds of events that every node knows about: its own computational events and its communication events with its peers. For instance, process PJ has no idea about the local computational events of PI. Lamport's logical clock builds on this very simple idea. And the idea is that we want to associate a timestamp with every one of the events that are happening in every process in the entire distributed system. How are we going to do that? Well, we're going to have a local clock, CI over here, and CJ over here. And this local clock can be anything. It can be a counter. It can be a simple counter. And what we are doing is, when I want to associate a timestamp with a particular event that's happening in my process, what I'm going to do is I'm going to look at this counter and see what the value of the counter is, associate that counter value as a timestamp for this event A. So for instance, here I've said that timestamp for A is 2. And this counter monotonically increases as we pile up events in our system. So once I've associated this timestamp 2 with this event A, I cannot associate the same timestamp with other meaningful events that are happening in my process. And therefore, I'll increment the timestamp. It's completely up to your implementation as to whether you want to increase this counter value by 1 or 2 by 1,000. It doesn't really matter. So in this case, for instance, I've incremented the timestamp counter by 2. And so the next event that I'm going to have in my process B is going to have a timestamp of 4. So that's the idea behind having a monotonically increasing counter to associate logical timestamps with the events that are happening in my process. Now, what about these communication events? Well, in particular, let's look at this case here. A is a communication event on process PI, and this communication event is going to have a timestamp of 2 associated with it, because that's the time that I generated this communication event, sent this message over, comes over to process PJ. When process PJ receives this, that's an event. And so let's say we call it event number D, and we have to associate now a timestamp with event D. How do I go about assigning a timestamp with this? Well, we know that this timestamp that I'm going to associate with this event D has to be greater than the timestamp associated with the send of that message, right? Obviously, you cannot receive a message that has not been sent yet. And therefore, we're going to say that D should have a timestamp which is at least greater than A for sure. Now, what else does D depend on? Well, it depends on other things that are happening in my own process. For that, I need to know what the current state of my local counter is. So, for instance, in my execution, as I'm showing you here, I haven't done anything meaningful yet, and therefore, my local counter is still pointing to 0, indicating that there's been no meaningful events here. So when this message comes, that's the first time I'm going to do something meaningful in this process, and I have to associate a timestamp with D. But I cannot associate the timestamp 0 with it, because the timestamp that I associate with D has got to be greater than the timestamp that is associated with the send event on process PI. And since the send event has this timestamp 2, I have to associate something higher than that. And so I associate a timestamp 3 with the receipt of this message. That is, this particular event is going to have a timestamp of 3. So the two conditions that we have talked about. One is that events that are happening in the same process, I'm going to have a monotonically increasing counter, and I'm going to use that to associate timestamps with the events that are happening in the same process. That's the first thing. That is, if I have two events, A and B, in the same process, and I know that A happened before B, because textually in the process, because the process is sequential, A happened before B, and therefore, the condition is that the timestamp associated with A has got to be less than the timestamp associated with B. Pretty straightforward. And similarly, the second condition is that if I have two events, A and B, and A happens to be a send event on some process, and D happens to be the receive event on another process, then we know that the receive event has to be after the send event. And therefore, the second condition is that CI of A, that is the timestamp associated with the send event, has got to be less than the timestamp associated with the receipt of the same message, CJ of D. So in order to make this condition, the second condition, valid, we're going to choose the timestamp to associate with the receipt of a message D as the max of the timestamp that is associated with the send event incremented by some quantity, CIA++. So in this case, it happens to be 2, so increment it and say 3. And then you want to know what the local counter is saying. So CJ, so what we pick as a timestamp to associate with D is the max of the incoming timestamp with the message and the local counter, whatever it is pointing to. So that's how I'll pick the timestamp to associate with a receive event. This brings up a very interesting question, and that is, what about timestamp of events that are happening concurrently in the distributed system? And before I talk about that, I want to give you a little quiz.